This session we will try to understand how our Android device, basically our mobile phone, can be useful for our some of those Internet of Things applications. How we can make use of this mobile application development for realizing some of those Internet of Things applications. So here, before we go into the application development, let me just brief you about introduction to Android. So basically, Android is a Linux-based operating system designed primarily for your mobile phones, such as your smartphones, tablets, and other things. So this Android company was basically founded by Palo Alto in California in the year 2003. So later, it was acquired by Google, and this is basically an open-source platform, open software for various mobile application developments. And you can realize this application development using Java. So the most important thing, if you are looking for application development for Internet of Things using your mobile phones, you should be conversant with the Java programming language. So if you look to the architecture of this Android, at the low level or at the nearest to the hardware level, you have the Linux kernel. So this Linux kernel is having the other drivers or the other softwares which are to be integrated for the other hardware resources. So as such, in your mobile phone, most of the mobile phones will have a camera, something like an audio and a Wi-Fi for communication purpose. And of course, some display for your touch screen and other things, something like a binder for inter-process communication. And of course, the battery, that is your power management. So at the Linux kernel, you have different softwares which are trying to manage your hardware resources. So if you look to the top hierarchy, we have certain libraries. Basically, these libraries will help you to manage and control your applications. So here, the libraries such as SQLite, basically your database software can be easily managed for your Android application. So the application can integrate with your database using your SQLite. You also have a free type. Free type, basically, you are converting to from your text to your bitmaps and for other kind of softwares to be converted. So you can use this free types, and you can have some security features using secure socket layers, and you can see the other libraries which are available here. So in addition to these libraries, the core libraries, which you can manage and control your application requirement and application environment properly, you have something on Android runtime core libraries too. So this runtime environment will enable you to run your on the mobile phones basically. And on the top of this libraries, you have the application framework where you can design and develop your applications. So mobile applications, basically, you can develop it and using various other software components here. So the software components such as your activity. What is an activity? Basically, any application that you are running on the mobile phone or on your Android phone is to be considered as an activity here. So you have different kinds of resource managers, package managers, so notification manager informing to the users from their applications, resource managers. Like this, all these are the application framework which will help you to develop your own application. And on the top of this, you have your applications, which the user is interacting with your mobile phone or along with your application that you have deployed onto the mobile device. So like this, it is a basic hierarchical structure, the Android architecture, this everybody needs to understand. So in the bottom layer, once again, basically, these are all the hardware devices, communication devices, communication drivers, cameras, display devices, and the Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, if you are having a USB, controller, USB monitor, controlling device with your mobile phone, your audio device, keypads, all these things are on the kernel level. And on the top of that, you have something called as hardware abstraction layer. So here, this hardware abstraction layer, software which will help you to interact with your sensors too. So the sensors, of course, these hardware components which are already integrated onto your mobile phone. So using these sensors, so in the olden days, it means in the last decade, people have not much used this hardware resources effectively using the application development. So these sensors will now help us to use them in a proper way. So we'll see what are those sensors and how we can use it. And as I mentioned to you, you have different libraries. These are your basically help you to manage and control your applications along with your runtime. So just in a very Android runtime libraries, we call it as, in addition to your core libraries. So this in the native libraries, as I also mentioned, SQLite, free types, your web kits and the media frameworks, if you want to put a multimedia there. Then you have the application frameworks itself using various resource managers, notification managers, and activity managers. These are the internal levels. Of course, we are not very much concentrating on each and every layer and each and every component here. But nevertheless, you just have an idea. So this is just an introductory part. Like any other similar framework development, you have this Android application framework for you to design and develop your own applications. If you see your Android apps, basically your applications of your mobile, you have a Java source file, you write your program in the .java file, it is compiled by your Java compiler, then you obtain your .class file. So everybody knows this particular step. So along with this .class file, you have other resources which you are going to be used along with this your .class file to be run on your runtime on your mobile device with your own virtual operating systems of your mobile device. So in order to use those dot classes and along with the resources of each those dot class, we use a file called Application Programming Interface, that is AAPT, which generates as the Android package file. This Android package file is having an extension of .apk file. So this is a .apk file is the one which is going to be run on your mobile phone or onto your hardware device. So this .apk file, again, if you have along with others assigned another applications with your security features, those security features will help you to secure your applications in a more strict manner. So this is your signed .apk file for your security purpose. These are the files which are going to be run on your hardware device, that is your mobile phone. If you see an activity, every Java application which is going to be run on a mobile phone, basically you can consider it to be an activity. So this activity, that is what your mobile app, if you technically see what is this activity implies is, you are going to start create that activity, of course, on start, you are going to run those activity. So this running that activity means you're using that mobile app. So when you're using a mobile app, it is in the running state, the activity is in the running state. So usually you are going to create it, you are going to start that activity, and you are going to resume it until you pause it, or you are going to stop that activity, and you are going to destroy if you are going to remove that activity from your mobile device. So this is just a simple life cycle. If at all a user is going to navigate to some other process or some other application, or he is going to have some interruption here, until unless that your activity is going to be running on your mobile device or on the activity system. So coming quickly to the Android application structure, so you have seen that Android mobile app is going to have something called as activity, which is the most important ingredient of your application. So these application components are the essential building blocks of those Android applications. So basically the most important components are your activities, that user interface will be there. You design and develop a user interface, graphical user interface, which is going to run on this activity. And services are those things which are running without a user interface, which are running on your mobile device in the background process. So some services, something like your Google Map services or something like in the background, they are going to monitor your whereabouts and something other services which you want to put it in the background service. So those are going to be run in the background services of your mobile phone. And you are going to also have a component called content providers. So these contents are basically to display your information, your contents in the form of various multimedia data. And you also have something called the broadcast receivers from the various points like your Google Map services, which you want to put some notifications, something like you want to send the notifications from your mobile app to so many other apps or to the other users. So you can use this broadcast receivers in a better way. So this is what told you here. We can just have an idea about what is an activity, what is a service, what is a content provider, and what is a broadcast receiver is. Usually, the basic process of building your mobile app is your Android project containing of all your resources and your main programming files and along with the other things that you are going to embed into your program through your packages and to your libraries. So once you prepare your .apk file, that is your Android package, once your Java program is compiled, your .class files are combined with your resource files. So you are going to get a package file .apk file. And along with this, you have something called Android manifesting, which is going to be depending on your device where you are going to deploy your this .apk file, or your application is going to be deployed on a particular hardware device on a particular phone, which having different model, different versions, what is the version and what are the other target system where you are going to deploy your application is going to be specified here in the Android manifest.xml file. So we are, once it has been securely signed, and you can run the particular Android package onto your device, or you can run that same application on your emulator too. So here, one important point everybody should have an understanding is something called as an intent. So what is an intent? In a mobile app, basically, intents are those things which you try to have some kind of connections, which can have some kind of asynchronous message passing between the activities. So an activity is basically a mobile app. That app can interact with another mobile app, which is basically nothing but an activity too. And these two activities, the internally nothing but your mobile apps, are going to be communicated using the internal component, something like intent. So activity one is going to have some certain intentions to interact with some activity two of your other mobile app, some message passings or some services or some kind of broadcast receivers, which activity one pass on to activity two. So like this, even activity two can also been passed on to activity one. A two-way communication can also be established between those mobile apps, which is internally governed by basically this intent application itself. So this another important thing, most you see that your application or your package is going to run on based on the settings that you put forward, or your configurations that you set it on your manifest file. So you must declare all your components in this particular application under the file called manifest file. So that will help the applications to understand and identify what are the users' permissions and declare the minimum APIs, application programming interface levels, where the Android has got different application programming interface levels. You might have seen jelly beans, and you might have heard something like other sets of, we'll see, I will tell you what are the different versions of Androids. So those different versions of Androids are given with different levels of APIs. So at present, I think you have the R and PQR, which is under the level of 30. So of course, there are so many features in each level. Each Android version has got different set of features, starting from, of course, some are already deprecated, and something around from 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. So we are now in the 30 or 31, something around. So these are the different API levels where you can have different programming features in different APIs. So it also supports different set of hardwares. This is one small snapshot which will give you what is the manifest file contains. So here, let me open the file first, the Android, then we'll come back to this manifest file. So once you install your Android Studio or your Windows or in your Ubuntu, so if you are running on Ubuntu, that is well ideally. So this Android Studio, if you see here, it is the one which I'm having on my system is having an integrated development environment of IntelliJ. So you can have your Android Studio if you have an Eclipse. Basically, one integrated development environment is also required, IDE. So you can have IntelliJ if you are going to have install here, or you can have your Eclipse. These are the most suitable things which you can support your Java programming language as such. So if you see here, the project or your application structure, basically your app structure. The app structure contains in three important things. One is your manifest, another your Java programming. Of course, I will tell the other programming languages which can be supported, but I think you are mostly aware of Java. Then you have the resource folder. So these are the folder structure where your application requires complete information about the application which you are going to repair, design and develop and deploy it onto your mobile phones. So here, that's what this manifest, basically this manifest is basically, name will be AndroidManifest.xml. So each and every one application that you design and develop are going to be configured or to be specified in this AndroidManifest.xml. If you see, this is an XML style of writing, and you can see this tag, which gives you the XML. Of course, the XML version number one, and your text encoding is on the UTF-8. And you are specifying the tag itself as a manifest tag, which can be run on your Android operating systems. And of course, the package name. So all these, your files, your manifest files, configuration settings, your Java actual programming logic, your business logic, of course, the logic of your application itself is spread in this programming language using Java. And the resources, something like if you are going to set something on the what are the what are the drawable things, if you are having an animation kind of things, if you are going to design in a particular layout for your things in the horizontal, in the vertical, the user interface layouts and the string values and all these things can be kept in this resource folder. Now here, this manifest file, if you see by default, this is one by default application. So this once this is it'll give you the applications, all these things are been, if you see the keys are basically, it is all meant for your Android here. So your Android, which is having certain other attributes here, what is an icon that needs to be displayed on your mobile phone, and what is the label that should be specified for your mobile app, and what is the launch that you are going to specify it, and supports your real-time synchronizations. Yes, it is true, synchronizations with your other set of applications. And the theme that you are going to specify, and basically the Android by default you'll have something on the main activity itself. The main activity is the name which the activity itself you are going to design. So let me just show you. I'll close this project. So once you install, because you have not seen that activity, I think you are, maybe you will be confused here. So let me close this project. So once you install your Android Studio, you'll get an option of create new project here. So click the create new project. Now it will be asking you what type of project are you going to repair or are you going to develop it. So if you see here, there are already templates are given to you, something like a main activity or empty activity, basic activity or a no activity itself. So basically all your apps are in the activity. So you can prepare an activities, you can prepare your services and for various things too. So suppose you're preparing for phone or tablet, that's what is the default options are given. If you're preparing for an Android TV, if you're preparing for an Internet of Things, the Android things itself, or if you're preparing a wearable gadgets like you on your something like Fitbit or your a watch, electronic watch, or if you are going to prepare something like a watch face. So all these things for different versions, the templates are given to you. So you can select a simple and empty activity. So an empty activity or app is going to look like this without any. And now if you see the other templates, you can see, understand what are the other templates. If you have a Google Maps activity, a login activity, username and a password is required for your activity itself. So you can choose an appropriate templates which are available for you. So I'm choosing an empty activity here, just for a small demo purpose. Then it will ask for you to specify the name. So one more important thing, whenever you are developing these things, so please see that you have sufficient storage. And of course, the RAM is also very much required. If you are using emulator too. So if at all it's just a simple applications you want to develop, if you don't want to use your emulator on this studio, and if you want to run directly on the mobile device itself, and then the, 4 GB of RAM is sufficient for you. So something like this, I prepare my application, you are going to give, by default the package name is given your .com, an example of my application. You can say, specify your own packages names. And you can select the language by default to be of Java. You can have Kotlin also. Again, I'll get back to the later stage, what is Kotlin. So don't confuse between these two at this moment. So these are the different Android versions. So Jelly Bean, if you're starting, basically this is application programming interface, APIs, level number 16. That's what they have given, the scientific community has given. So if you see there is levels here, so you can go up to R, that is the latest Android version R, which is application programming interface 30. mostly most of your apps which have been you are using mostly will mean the Marshmallow or your Nuggets or your Oreo. Pi QR still I think people are not using those apps at this moment, but the older versions of Androids, Android 4.1, starting with Jelly Bean. So most likely if you develop an application from your Jelly Bean onwards, you can use it on the other Android versions too, most likely most of the applications. But if you develop a version application with Android 10 of Q version, it may not be able to run on your older versions of Androids. Some of the users may have these old phones, old mobile phones with older versions of Android. So when you develop an application with the latest one of Android, those may not be done. So please make sure in the beginning stage, if you are a beginner, start using from the Jelly Bean itself. So here you can see clearly your app will run approximately on 99.8% of the devices of the users who are using Android phones. If you see here, if you use something like the R latest system, it is less than 1% of the devices. So still Android 11, that is the R version, is not come in the market in a very widespread manner. So use please develop your applications using Jelly Bean. So click set the settings and go to click finish. So once you get back, you will get back to this particular stage. So it is building up. You can see it is the package folder structure is getting loaded. And you can see at the bottom, there is a Gradle, which will help you to build up all the, like your compilation and your configurations of your mobile apps or your applications can be easily built up here. So once it is this loaded, it will take a couple of minutes to prepare its folder structure. Yes, now it is done. So if you see, these are the basic three folders. One is the manifest, the other one is the Java, another is the resource. These are the three important folders that is required for your application. So in the example which I have shown you in the last week is about collecting the sensors data. That's basically your accelerometer sensors data and putting it on your mobile app. So that is just a basic example. I will get back to that programming and explain the logic to you with respect to these three folders in a short while. Before that, let me just give you some more information here. So this is how you have a manifest file. So this manifest file is basically this, which you need to provide it for you to run it on the target device. So that is your, this is what Android manifest.xml. This is basically an XML style of lighting. So all your XML tags are going to be there from here to here. So let us see what is this manifest file is. So your application must declare all its components in this file. That is your manifest file. So which is your main activity file and what are the resources and what is the target and what is the version which you are using. All that information is you need to specify here. So the manifest does a number of things in addition to declaring the application components, such as identify any user's permissions to this application requires, declare the minimum API level required by the application, and declare the hardware and software features used to required by the application, and the API libraries and so on and so forth. So this is how your basically your declaration section of your manifest file looks like. Here you are specifying what is the version of your application along with what is the minimum SDK version is required, the software development kit version of Android. Then where is the icon? If you are specifying any icon for your mobile app that needs to be displayed, you can design it and you can put it on this particular folder structure. So you are going to put your icon as an image file under the drawable. Basically, this drawable folder is a subfolder on your layouts in the resources under the layouts and layout and the drawable folder structure. You are going to specify the icon over here if you are going to specify it. Otherwise, you can put it as a default. You'll get the Android symbol itself. And what is the name of your main activity file? That is your dot main activity file. And if you're specifying any intentions that you need to interact with other apps, you can specify it here. These are just a simple manifest file. Then you have the application resources. So your resources are these RES, which is you are getting here. These are your application resources. Basically, you are specifying all those resources here. So here in the resources, for every resource that you include in your Android project, the software development kit, build tools define a unique identity. which you can use it to reference to the resource. So all those resources are also going to be specified using extended markup language. So you can use your XML style of writing to specify the resources, like in your user interface, what components you are going to specify it in the designing of your application. Similarly, you have something on Android project itself. So here, this is in the project, you have the actual code that needs to be specified here. So you have the actual main activity, which has been specified in terms of Java code here. So this is the actual Java code, which will be having, including all your something like, because it is basically a blank activity which you're chosen in the initial stage. So that you're going to get only that kind of a library file importing, and you are writing the class main activity, the name of the main class, which is extends the application compatibility activity, and you are going to have the on create function. So every activity has got if you have seen the life cycle of that activity, you are going to create it. So that create is going to have this main activity, and your once the create function is executing, it is created your activity, then you are going to run it. So of course, you are not completed the main things here, that I'll get back to that in the example stage. In addition to the main activity, which you specify the actual logic or the business logic where your application is going to perform, whatever the logic you specify here, you also have something on the Android test, and you have something called test. So here, this Android test is basically, you can run your program on the Android environment with the Android framework. Whereas this test, which is simply a test which you can helpful for you to perform the unit test, so which is going to be run on your target machines or on your target devices without any Android dependencies. So in Android test, once you develop, design and develop your application, you can run and test it on your Android framework with all the dependency files which you can test it here. But after testing all the dependency files, so everything is running fine, you can go for the unit testing. So without the Android framework, you can test those things and see how your application is going to work for various inputs. So these are the folder structure. Everybody needs to understand what this particular folder structure is. So once you understand this, very simple things, which you, if you are conversant with your Java programming language, it will be very much useful for you. So this is what your main activity .java file, which you are going to be specified in the source directory. You are going to write that particular thing. Then followed by, you can specify the generated Java files, the r.java file, which is a generated version for your abstract windowing toolkits and as well as your generated program structure. Then if you can specify the assets, basically your .apk Android package is where you are going to be stored in the assets folder. Once you compile it, once you build it, and once it is gradle is completed, you can have this in the file assets. So you can see in the resources, the other set of libraries that are required for you to run along with the class file, you are going to keep them in the libraries here. So in the resources, you can see if you want to put some animations, if you want to design it, and you want to put it in a particular structure, and if you want to have menus and the values and all, you can all specify it under this particular folder structures. So all these folder structures will helpful for you to put your components resources in a proper way. So that information you can see basically for animation objects. You might have seen already mobile apps, your images, all those images can be put under this particular folder structure. So your XML colors, then similarly your layouts. So under the layouts, you can put it either you want to have the app in the horizontal or in the vertical style, and your in the interface, what are the components in the interface, like text boxes, your labels, all these things. Using your XML, you can specify the components on that particular thing. Similarly, the menu items for your application, the raw data, and of course the Android manifest, what are the file you are going to specify, the application programming interface labels, all these things you put it in these different things. Now, the important thing that we need to understand at this point is on the hardware-oriented features. Since the mobile phone is having camera, sensors, you have the, on the software packages, so where you can use your camera class, the Java class, the sensor class itself, sensor manager, which you can manage those things, and the sensors event listener. Whenever you are using a particular sensor of your mobile phone, you can use it, you can listen through that means you can do operate those sensors using the sensor event listener. So this is like you are you prepared a GUI on your Java programming on the graphical user interface. You know what is this event listener method is and what is the event is. Any user interacting with that particular mobile app or to the application is an event which triggers something to be done, when, which triggers or something to be performed whenever some action is to be performed by the user. So similarly, you have a media recorders, you have a geomagnetic fields, and you have a face detector. All these are different software components which are already available to you on the Android apps for you to easily interact with the hardware. So for the next one exercise or for the assignment which I'm going to give it you on the Android app, so all of you must be aware of what is a sensor type. That's basically sensor class. How do you use a sensor class? Basically, these sensors are your accelerometers, your light, magnetic field, proximity, temperature sensors, or your orientations sensors, which are means proximity sensors. All these different sensors may be available on your mobile phones. At least one, two, three sensors will be there. Each one of you might have a mobile phone, so you can make use of those sensors. And whenever you use those sensors, you need to use the sensor class, the software, and you can interact and you can program. You can do a programming exercise on these particular sensors. So you can develop your own user interface and interact with them and prepare your own application. So what application you have to prepare, I will give it in the question. But anyway, you need to be aware of how do you make use of this sensor class in the corresponding library. So you have to do something on Android application that accesses the positioning sensors. So this is one exercise which you need to look for you to do in the coming week. So you can make use of and one more thing, you can have a security features. You can incorporate security and have some authentication where you want to use those hardware resources effectively. Please remember, all your mobile apps basically use each app is going to run an individual process, and each individual process has its own virtual machine. So that's why whenever multiple apps are running on your mobile phone is happening because of each one is having its own virtual machine over there. So an application course runs in isolation from other applications. So that is the advantage of this mobile apps using different hardware resources on the same gadget. So these are the references where I have collected the material and have discussed with you. You can further explore these things. So let me just show you the program which we discussed in the last week. There's accelerometer. Where is this? My access? Yes, my accelerometer application. This is the program which I already given to you, and the source codes are available to you. The source codes are given here on the our course page. So using sensors, the accelerometer sensors of the mobile phone, and displaying the values on the Android app. So the demo of this one is given in the Tuesday's class. So you can see this recording of the lecture and this demo. But let me just explain the program. So I have given just a background about what is the manifest file, and what is your actual Java code, and the resources that are available here. So in this application, so if you see the manifest file, of course the actual program starts with your resources. So in this order only, let me explain to you. So in the layout of this particular thing on this app, I have prepared one, and this is what. So if you see, there are accelerometer, you have X, Y, Z. So X axis, Y axis, and Z axis. So on the interface, when you run this program on your mobile phone, you are seeing something in a heading, the text called something called as accelerometer. So with this one text as an accelerometer, along with this, this is what your XML definition of that particular text. So the text size is 25 points, text color is given, and the layout width, height, basically the default values have been taken here. Just only the accelerometer value has been specified here. That's what the text. And you have another text item here, that is your x-axis value. And similarly, the x-axis value is also going to have certain text size, the color, everything has been specified, but with the default values. So like this, you have x-axis value, you have a y-axis value, and you have a z-axis value. So this x, y, z along with the heading. So this is what the layout you are specified here on your Android app. So that's what just a simple. So the main activity has been given. This is the by default the main activity name is given here for this resource. Once you prepare your resource, yes, please. Somebody is asking some doubt. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So like I got doubt like for every word or for every text value should we write the whole XML?
Yeah, sorry. Every internal thing, every internal component, you need to provide the corresponding definition here.
Like, isn't there any thing called like writing a function and calling it if the text is repeated?
It is up to you.
Like if the layout is repeated.
Yeah, if you say this what the same okay. thing, you can reuse these things. The reusability is there. Since I'm just keeping in view of a beginner, for a first beginner purpose, you can make use of these things like this. You can start writing like this. But once you are confident, once you are conversant in preparing these applications, I will tell you the other tricks there. Means other ways of preparing your own user interface. Okay, because for a beginner, okay. you used to start always from this particular stage. That's why I have given this example.
Mm-hmm.
Once you complete this, I will tell you. Yeah. Yeah. Now, this is what you are designing is. That's what you have seen. You can see this output which I have given in this particular video. If you see the recording of this lecture, end of the lecture, I have given the demo. You can see the output of this. Basically, the output is coming from this activity main.xml file only. Now, the actual code, if you see that the actual code is given in the Java, my accelerometer application. So this is what your the actual code main activity .java file. So here, if you see the you are using something called as a sensor manager. Already, I just now mentioned to you, what is a sensor manager. So the sensor manager is a sensor class. If you see this one example in the slides I have given to you, we will not go for more than that, please. But I request all of you to just understand this sensor. What are the classes? So sensor manager is a class that permits access to the sensors available within the Android platform. You can see this particular text. This is a sensor manager, and there are other methods related to the sensor manager sensor itself, the sensor event listener and the sensor event and the sensor itself. So you can use get sensor list. What are the available sensors that are there on your mobile phone? You can use this get sensor list method. It will automatically display what are all the available sensors in your mobile phone. So like this, you are using the class here in the actual Java program, sensor manager. And of course, your x-axis value, that's what your x, y, z, three variables. And of course, the you can declaring a local variable sx, xy, sy, and sz, the local variables of string type. These are all your local variables x, y, z, and sx, sy, and sz for your program to collect the value from your text view 1, text view 2, text view 3. So text view 2, text view 1, what is the text view 1 here? Can anybody say me what is text view 1? Of course, I use 2, 3, 4, but what happened to 1?
It's an ID, no, sir. So any name can be there.
No, it is not an ID. If you see here carefully, again, once again, I'm coming back to this resources in the drawable, in the layout structure. Just see here carefully. What is text view one? The text view one is something like, which is given to?
You are using it as a heading of the
thing. Yes, very good. If you have seen that application, when the application is running, this is just an a heading here. So that heading is given with a variable name text view one. That's why, anyway, this heading doesn't make any sense in our actual programming process. So here the programming process involves, you want to display your x-axis value, y-axis value, and z-axis value. This is your x value. The x value is given with your variable name or your ID number. That is basically your text view two. And you are just declaring. These are all declarations in the layout manager. So that's what your y value is given with an ID text view 3, and your z value, to display the z value of your accelerometer, you are using the text view 4. this is like your GUI development, what you have done in your Java only. Something like you are giving an ID number for your text boxes. This is your text boxes only, text view 2, text view 3, text view 4. So you are using that text view 2, text view 3, and text view 4 into your ID value of this. So it is by default, R will be the common thing for all the generated codes once it is compiled. And you get system service. So you are using the Android, the system service of this. Your sensor manager is initiated, the instance is created here, and it is listening to that. So what are the, to which sensor it is listening? It is listening to a sensor type accelerometer. So once you give specify here, this of course we are not using the other methods. By default you get on create options, on accuracy change. Of course if you want to program it, you can modify these functions whenever there is some accuracy changing or on create options menu like this. So now you are on sensor change. So XYZ values are getting changed. So those XYZ values, what you do is you are getting that particular sensor type accelerometer values. The event is happening here. So those event values 0, 1, 2, and you are collecting it from those events onto X value, Y value, and Z value, and you are going to display it onto your screen using your string here. So the string SX, SY, SZ gets the exact values of your X, Y, Z axis value, and those values are going to be set onto your XX, XY, SY, and SZ values have been set onto your set text functions of your layout manager that you specified in your layout activity main. So just collecting the values and displaying the values. This is what we are simple program here using the sensors manager. If you see, this is the library. So here the library is the sensor event listener, sensor manager, sensors. So you already imported these things. By default, you'll not have this. So you have to import these libraries further to collect those sensor values. So this is a small program. That's what, and the final program, the final file is basically your AndroidManifest.xml. So this Android manifest XML contains basically what SDK version you are using that you are developing here, and you are specifying this main activity function name of your class, which is getting which has been compiled, and you are going to use it on your application. Once you specify it in your manifest.xml file, that's it. You are seeing you of course the icons, the strings values, you are not using anything, so I do not specify anything over here. So you can see this is what a simple thing, very simple by default file. So you just take these files, all these three files are available for you, and practice it and see your XYZ values,
sir. Do we need to update the manifest manually or something like that, or
Update for what? Manifest file? No need to update. Once your SDK version is the software development kit version, because I selected, if you see the API level which I've selected here is 17. So Jelly Bean from here. No need to update. If you are going to run this particular program on a different set of operating systems, you need to update this manifest file.
Like sir, if you have multiple screens or something in our app, then do we need to add those values? And
if your application, you mean to say, see, if you are developing a single app with only one activity, this is what you are going to have it. Okay, as I mentioned to you, when you are developing your application, you need to fix up yourself what type of activity or what type of app you are going to use it. So here, when I have chosen this empty activity, there are no multiple set of screens to be open or multiple activities to be run, or there is no connection, there is no requirement of activity interacting with another activity here. So in this example, there is no connections between these activities. There is no intents are there. So when there are no intents here, there is no requirement of any updations of this manifest file. If you are going to have intents in the sense, if you are communicating one activity to another activity, if you are exchanging some asynchronous information, either your images or your latest notifications or your broadcastings, then you require here. for a simple application, you don't require anything. Hello. Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, actually, the why I'm giving this Android application development on the Internet of Things is, as already I mentioned to you, so you have these sensors. So basically, these sensors, what you need to understand carefully. So for our IoT themes of applications too. So this is one particular area where you can make use of the best use of these sensors. What are the available sensors here? And you can prepare your own applications, and you can just give it on your Google Play Store. Like I have shown in the last class, how do you, once you develop your application using Android Studio, you can select, of course, here the emulators are there, but you can select if you want to run it and test it, those apps on the real devices. Once you connect your mobile device, this program, once it is compiled, you can be directly loaded onto your mobile app. So then, similarly, how do you put your, how do you host your applications? So you need to host it through a particular service provider, or through, you need to host it onto your web server, and you need to connect it. So I will tell you how to host your own onto your Google Play Store, and how do you secure these things in a later stage. At this moment, I will just make you to understand a simple preparation of the file. And the most important thing that what I am expecting is there anyone who is interested to develop this mobile app? Of course, one small project task is going to come to me, so I would like to take the help of you people to prepare this mobile apps, mobile application, of course, Android. Later we'll go for iOS, that is a different case, so everything cannot be done on one single day. So how to prepare iOS applications is another aspect. I will tell you how to do that one. Of course, that needs your iPhone or your Mac or your tablets. And you need to have the, like your studio, you have the other softwares for that. But let me, I have one requirement from you all. Those who are interested to develop a mobile app using geofencing, a geofencing application. Of course, I discussed with the MTech students. Only one student has come forward. I may like to hear from you. I'll give the details for you. Basically, that is a geofencing tag. Means geofencing. You know what is a geofencing? You might have heard this up to now so far, maybe.
Yes, sir.
This particular task or this assignment will be apart from your the regular assignments I'm going to give to you. So you need to spend a little bit time, and some of your efforts are also required. And you need to be dedicated, and this is very a time-bound project task. Within 2 to 3 weeks, this has to be completed too. So if you, somebody is interested,
In this, I'm just generally asking, in this, is it only about collecting data or some performing some analysis on that?
Yes, analysis also has to be done. Are you talking about the application development, or are you talking about the Android in general?
Have to collect data from analysis on the Android app.
Are you referring to the project task which we are going to start doing regarding that you are mentioning?
Yes.
Yeah, that requires basically data collection. There won't be any analysis in that one, in the project task.
Okay, sir.
Can you give an idea about geofencing? I don't know that.
Repeated, your voice is very low.
I'm saying, can you give an idea about geofencing? I don't know that actually.
Geofencing, basically geographically. See, something, you have a latitude and a longitude coordinates will be there about your position. Suppose what happened is, you can understand in very simple way like this. So if you are holding your mobile phone and you are standing on a particular at a particular location, maybe in your home or you're outside your home or on a particular road. So wherever your mobile phone which is held by you, it has been having certain coordinates. So it has been identified with a set of locational values, positional values, positioning. So you know what is XY coordinates, right? So those XY coordinates are nothing but basically your latitude and your longitudinal coordinate values. So the exact location where you place. So you might have seen, you might have used your cab booking, or you are going to look for Google Maps. You might have seen, if you want to reach your particular place, your different directions are coming from the current location. How do you go to a different destination like this? You might have seen different applications, apps which are already been deployed and you have been used. So basically, all those things are been working on something called as positional values, locational values. So each location has got a latitude and a longitude. And if you are want to fine tune those latitude and longitude to a very minimal distance, within 5 meters or 10 meters or within 50 meters, you can also have a radius value specifying. So this latitude, longitude, and along with the radius value, you can, if you are going to geographically monitor a particular person's, whether he is belonging to the particular area or not, he is present in a particular location or not, so you can put up a virtual wall, a virtual fencing. So that fencing is basically through your latitude and longitude, you specify what is the boundary for that person. Whenever that person enters into that boundary, so when he enters into the boundary, means he basically, you set a latitude and longitudinal values. So you will come to know whether the person is entered into that location or not. So like this, when you go to a cinema theater or your shopping mall, so usually whenever you go to a big shopping mall along with the mobile phone, so if you enter into the shopping mall with the mobile phone, so your mobile phone is giving your positional values, the latitude and longitudinal values. So it implies that you are entering to the mall. And once you enter the mall, obviously that mall will give you some notifications like your business offers, what the mall is offering to you and all. So that mall is collecting your positional values. And once you exit that particular mall, it means you are out of that virtual wall. So you are out of those latitude and longitudinal values. So those latitude and longitudinal values monitoring by your mobile phone using your proximity sensors and other sensors, that will help you to monitor where whereabouts about yourself or something like that. I hope have you understood now?
Yes, sir. And I actually worked on a similar project 2 or 3 years ago. And it was actually locating the garbage. People usually put the garbage roadside. So I worked on similar thing that people can update the coordinates while they are traveling.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. So I think,
can work on this.
Yeah, very good, very good. Good to hear. So this one exercise which I'm giving to you, of course, all of the this is to do. This is what I told you, Android application that access your positioning sensors. So anyway, one assignment I'm going to give you all in this coming week on Tuesday's class. I will give the first assignment to you, which involves your Android, which involves your Arduino, which involves Raspberry Pi. So using these three devices, your first assignment will be there with the different exercises. You will see that questions in the Tuesday's class. Of course, all the practical things will be there, which will not bore you. So what I am suggesting is, so Suam, I think then will you be able to spare some time in doing this task? This will be in addition to all your courses and all your other assignments. So this is one project task. So I cannot give you any funding or. But nevertheless, if we are succeed in deploying this project, then will be a nice future prospects will be there.
Yes, sir, I can work on this.
We need to be very serious. That's what I request students to come forward who can sincerely put some, means of course, all my students do some sincere efforts, but the thing is the time is the management. So you need to utilize the time properly and need to allocate some time to these things. And somebody is joining now on the bus. I don't know. So this project task, I will give you the details. We have a meeting on Monday with those the customer, our university persons only, so higher authorities. Once we discuss with them clearly, and I'll get back these details to you on Tuesday or Thursday. We will have separate meeting on these things. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
I'll update you on Wednesday morning, most likely. Any other queries, please? Yeah, so please go through this material about the Android application development. Maybe it is very new to most of the people, but nevertheless, it will. Once you are have the Java programming idea and XML, that is enough. Not more than that, anything is there. We'll do just a couple of exercises on the Android application mobile development using the sensors. But if you have any queries, please put forward. Go through the material, which is already there, introduction to Android, whatever I discussed here, and you can further ask me on Tuesday's class too. But for this session, I will just wind up. If you have any queries, please put forward.
Hello, sir.